Hey church, our theme and our vision for 2024 has been the word revive. And our pastor has cast a wonderful vision, and we have seen an amazing first quarter here at Victory Baptist Church. From our kids department, to our teens, to our young adults, all the way through our senior saints, we have grabbed hold of and ran with the vision that pastor has cast to us, which is a commitment revive. And now that we have revived our commitment together this first quarter, it's time to move on to quarter two and be the hands and feet of Jesus. And let's move on to a community revive. We're so thankful for these amazing opportunities in quarter two that we're gonna get to do. Watch this. Hey church, our first outreach activity we're doing in the second quarter of Community Revived is we're having a community outreach day on April 27th. We'll all meet at the church at 8:30 and we'll go all throughout the community to help revive our city. We're actually right here on location at the Living History Park, which is a place we will come to help re-beautify and love on our city. We'll also be going through different thoroughfares and picking up trash and helping redo the signs of the community. Hey, mark it down, April 27th. We'll meet at the church at 8:30, Community Cleanup Day. We cannot wait to see you there. Another amazing outreach opportunity we get to be involved in is on May 2nd, which is the National Day of Prayer. Mayor Britton Williams, right here in North Augusta, has asked Victory to help him spearhead a project in order to pray over the entire city. On May 2nd at 8 a.m., we will meet at Second Providence Baptist Church for morning prayer, and then that night at 6, we'll meet at Victory Baptist Church and all break up into teams and walk all throughout the streets and pray over the entire city. What an amazing day we can be involved. Write it down, May 2nd, sign up on the Church Center app, and don't forget, let's pray over our city. Hey church, another amazing outreach opportunity this quarter that we're going to be involved in is May Day right here at the Mission. On May 18th, it's a Saturday, we'll be coming down here and helping Brother Pat and all these amazing men down here at the Mission to help renovate and to do some work around down here at the Garden City Rescue Mission. That's on May 18th. And then on the 19th, the very next morning, Sunday morning at Victory, we're doing a supply drive to bring in all kinds of shirts and undergarments and supplies that the Mission will need on that day. It's gonna be an amazing weekend here at the Mission. You don't wanna miss it. All the details that you need are in the Church Center app. Sign up today, May Day at the Mission, May 18th and 19th at Victory Baptist Church. We'll see you then. Well, Jesus told us to go to Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and literally to the ends of the earth. And I don't know about you, church, but I'm so excited to join hands with you, join hands with our community, making a difference, and let's see a community revived.
On June 2nd, 2020, our lives changed. Our daughter, Kennedy, was diagnosed with cancer. Since that time, we have had a burden to help others that are going through their own cancer battles.
We would like to invite current cancer patients, cancer survivors, and cancer caregivers to the launch of Beauty for Ashes Cancer Support on Thursday, April 25th at 6 o'clock in the Fellowship Building. You can register online at the Church Center app, or you are welcome to email us with any questions at cancersupport@victorybc.com.
Our goal in this group is we want you to know that you're not alone in this battle.
Hey church, camp meeting is just around the corner and God always does some amazing, incredible things. In the teen department, we have decided to get together and take some teenagers out to the tabernacle to do some prayer. And so we want you to use our prayer buckets. So every Sunday from now until camp meeting, these prayer buckets will be on the altars at church. And we would love for you to write something down. There'll be pens and paper available. Write what you're praying for down, put it in this prayer bucket, and all of our teenagers will grab these prayers out of this bucket. We'll head down to the tabernacle right before camp meeting starts, and we'll be praying over every single one of these needs. We can't wait for camp meeting. We can't wait to see what God's gonna do. Use these prayer buckets. We love you, church.
Hello, Victory Seniors. I'm not Miss Kim, but I'm here to remind you about the senior meal, April 18th at 6:30 in the Fellowship Building. We're so glad to see everybody today at church. We hope you have a great day. Let's go to church.
Good morning. Stand to your feet, Victory. Let's sing some music together. This song says, I saw the light. Here we go.
Oh, fellas, help us out. Sing, guys, ready?
I was a fool to wonder and stray. Straight is the gate and narrow the
way.
Now I have traded the road.
Come on, Sopranos.
Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
We'll give the Lord a hand clap this morning. I'm thankful one day we saw the light. Do you remember the day that you ran headlong into Jesus? Amen. He saved our souls. What a good day it was. Today we've come to make much of him, to praise him, and to worship him. We're going to sing one more song together as a congregational. I'm thankful for this song and for what it means to us here at Victory. Do you remember the day when you were going through a trial and a difficulty, and Jesus was there every step of the way to help you through? Amen. Let's sing this song out. He's our defender. Come on, choir, lift your voice to the Lord.
Close to the weary of heart.
In his name.
bless his holy name. Can anybody testify that you are grateful that he is your defender? And he is our deliverer. And he is a strong tower. And no matter what you walked in this room with today, I'm thankful you don't have to walk out with it, because he is a mighty strong Savior today. We welcome you to church today. This is a wonderful place to be, and we're so grateful that you are here. And our hope and our prayer is not that you just have a religious experience, but that the Holy Ghost will sit right there beside of you, speak to your heart, and do something for you that you cannot do by yourself. It is a joy to be here. If you are a guest with us, we are so grateful and so thankful that you're here today. Whether somebody invited you, whether you found us online, we are so grateful that you are here. And I hope our team got some information from you as you walked in. But if not, there's a graphic on the screen. We would love for you to send us a text message to that number and just put the word victory in the text message, and you'll get a video from me. And we would love to give you a free gift to let you know how much we appreciate you being in church with us today. We also want to welcome all the people that tune in all across, from everywhere, that tune in across and watch the broadcast. And I hope and pray God will speak to you. If you would like free information about how to join our online campus, there's a graphic on your screen as well. Church family, I need you all to help me welcome all of our guests and everybody tuned in today and make them feel right at home. You can be seated. We want to welcome the Breedlove family from Tennessee, the Cope family from Tennessee. Where y'all at? Raise your hand. Well, God bless you. Glad to have you here in church with us today. And I need you all to help me welcome the Nealon family. It's going to be singing for us today and tonight. We're thrilled that they're here. And it's just a real joy. Don't forget, if you are new to our church family, and I know a lot of people are still out on vacation renting their homes for Master's Week, but right around the corner on April the 21st is our Next Steps class. We have been doing that at lunchtime, but this coming time on the 21st, we're going to do a breakfast at 8:15. That'll be in the fellowship building, so make sure you sign up or call the office for that. And we would absolutely love for you to be a part of the Next Steps class. That is just if you've been coming and you enjoy the church and you want to know, hey, what's next? How do I become a member of the church? All those questions. What does this church believe? What's the vision? Everything you need for that. I will personally give that to you in that class on the 21st. Also, baptism next Sunday on April 21st. And then don't forget the barbecue lunch next Sunday in the fellowship building. It'll be a blessing. I want the ushers to make their way down. And we're going to worship the Lord and give, and we're going to get all this stuff out of the way. I want to hear the Nealons and the choir sing. And don't miss tonight. Tonight we're going to dedicate the whole service. We're going to move everything out of the way from the normal, and we're just going to turn the whole service over to the Nealons. And they're going to do a good old-fashioned Southern Gospel concert for us tonight. And we want the whole church to come out and support that. God may or may not infest your bed with insects if you stay home watching TV tonight when you're supposed to be in church. Somebody say amen. Don't let me invite friends to town and then y'all say, well, preacher ain't preaching, so we just going, no. You come to church tonight. We'll start at 5 o'clock. We'll be done right after 6 o'clock or so. It'll be wonderful. And don't leave me hanging on that, all right? Y'all come on in, and I promise you, after that's over, the TV will still work and you'll find out who won the Masters. And we'll find out all day long who the real master is. Somebody say amen right there, all right? So you come to God's house, and I appreciate the goodness of God. The Lord has been so, so very good to us, and we're so grateful for his goodness and his mercy and all that he's done. How many could testify that he has been way better to you than you deserve? How many soldiers, if you're a soldier with us today, would you stand? Let us recognize the soldiers that come to church today. We're thankful for them. From Fort Eisenhower, coming to church. God bless you all, and we thank God for you. How many of you, this is your last Sunday with us today? Raise your hand. There's several of them that they're being put somewhere else, ordered somewhere else. And so you be praying for them. And for the rest of you, y'all just keep inviting and keep coming. And we love you. God bless you. You can be seated. God bless you. You give as unto the Lord, and I promise you, you cannot outgive God today. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray that you would bless the remainder of this service. I pray, God, that you would bless this offering. Bless those that have to give and those that do not. I pray, Holy Ghost, that you would help us today enter into a season of worship. Lord, you have been so faithful to us. And you have been so good to us. And I am so grateful that we can trust in you in these crazy days. And Lord, I pray you'd anoint the Nealon family. They do this all the time, different churches, different places. I pray a special anointing on their family. I pray you'd let their hearts calm down. And I pray, Lord, you'd let them do exactly what you created them to do today. Lord, I pray that they wouldn't be the ones helping other people today as much. Lord, I pray that this church would be a blessing to them today. I pray, God, that it would be a breath of fresh air for them today. And Lord, I pray you'd help our church to be a blessing to them all day long. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray, and all God's people said, amen and amen. You give as unto the Lord, and listen as they sing.
Sing the chorus, come on.
And how marvelous, how wonderful in my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my song.
Yes, one more time with a loud voice. Everybody, come on, sing it this morning. Come on.
How marvelous
is
believe it today, church? I said, do you believe it today? All right. We're going to need a little help on this song right here. I don't know if preacher's out there or not, but we're going to have to help a little bit on this. All right, everybody in the house, come on.
Going home with Jesus in the twinkling of an eye. I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment or I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls the church away.
Well, I'm going home with Jesus in the twinkling of an eye.
I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. Or I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away.
For the trumpet to sound most any time, and a crown of life is waiting. Thank God it'll soon be mine. I got my invitation at a place called Calvary. Through the precious blood of Jesus, this trip's been paid for me.
I'm a going home with Jesus in the twinkling of an eye. In the twinkling of an eye. If I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky, I may not know the moment or may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away.
Some help on this one, all
right? Everybody, come on. Well, I'm going home with Jesus in the twinkling of an eye. I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment or may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. Jesus, in the twinkling of an eye, if I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky, I may not know the moment, or I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away. I may not know the moment, or I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his church away.
So very, very honored to be here today and to celebrate who the Lord is, what he's done in our life, and it's just a huge honor. We've been looking forward to this. I love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Sing the chorus, all my life, everybody come on, sing it.
Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Yeah.
All my life you have been
faithful.
So good.
With every breath.
With every breath that I am able. Oh, I will sing of the goodness.
One more time, all my life. I love this song.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness.
You know what makes that such a beautiful sound this morning is that we all kind of bring in different brokenness, a different history, and a different story of redemption. We bring that into a place like today, and we celebrate who the Lord is because we know what He has done in our lives. I love the scripture. It says we've not been made just mere conquerors. We've been made more than conquerors through His precious blood. But when we come into a place and with all the baggage that we carry and all the hurt and all the days of despair and the sleepless nights and the trials that felt like that God was just a universe away removed from our troubles. And we come into this place and we begin to sing of His goodness in spite of our troubles and trials. It doesn't make sense to a lost world. You get a bad doctor's report, a few months to live, we sing of His goodness. Going through all kinds of relationship struggles and it feels like that your world is falling apart, we come in here this morning and we sing of His goodness. You know, we sing the old song about, I stand upon the promises, standing on the promises, standing on the promises of God my Savior. But we got to remember that those promises are not just for peace and prosperity in this life. Jesus said, in this life you would be hated. In this life you would have troubles and trials. In this life you would walk through difficult valleys. In this world, He said, you would have trouble. But Jesus also said, I have overcome the world. And the peace that I give you is not peace that the world gives. It's my peace I give unto you. That's why we can sing of the goodness, because the peace of Jesus transcends every care, every broken heart in this place this morning. My family and I, we're no different from you. We go through struggles. My girls are singing right now with broken hearts. We've gone through some great loss in the past couple of weeks. But my friends, there's something special. There's something powerful when we begin to sing of His goodness in spite of our brokenness. Because I do know this, if He chose never to bless me from this moment on, He would still be worthy of all praise for who He is. He is God, and He is God alone. You can never be separated from the love of God this morning, friends. You are in a good place because God is about to change your every single detail of your life. If you'll just open up and give Him praise in spite of your hurt, in spite of the pain, in spite of your past, just praise Him and worship Him in spirit and truth, because the love of God goes before you. He is behind you. He is a sure foundation beneath you. He is a tower of refuge over you. There is nowhere that you can go to separate you and your family from the mighty, loving hand of an almighty God this morning. Do you believe it, church? Can you say amen?
Your goodness is running
Storm was gone.
many's thankful that the morning came? Stand to your feet. Let's give the Needlands another hand and thank them for being in church with us this morning. Harry, can you get the ushers together? Can we get the ushers together to take up another offering for them? When we talked to them about coming, they did not, you can be seated, they didn't ask for any money. They didn't tell me how much money they had to have, which is a, kind of a pet peeve to me a little bit. But I appreciate their willingness to come and minister, and they're going to be with us this morning and again tonight. And we say this all the time, that we're blessed to be a blessing. And we want to be a blessing to them. We don't want to just be such a blessing to them for today, but we know that there's churches that they've been to and churches they're going to that maybe they can't be as good to them as we can. And so here's how we're going to do this. As always, we're going to take up an offering. If you need to write a check out, you can write it to Victory Baptist Church, and you have my word. Every single dime that comes in this offering, we will give to the Neyland family. And I think it's a right thing for us to be a blessing to them and a help to them. They got a big bus out there they travel in. And how many of y'all know that diesel isn't free? But it costs them to come here. We want to make sure we take care of all of that and be a blessing to them. And Josh, while we take up the offering, I want the choir to sing, "I Trust in God." Can we do that right before preaching time? We'll sing a little bit. Wow, that'll give them a rest. Father, I pray that you'd help us to be a blessing to the Neyland family today. Thank you for their ministry, their songs that have ministered to us and as a church for years and years and years. I pray, God, that you bless this offering. Help us to be a blessing to them. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. And all God's people said, amen, amen, and amen. He talked about it a little bit. Their family has been going through a season of trial and difficulties. And I wouldn't want to get into their life or broadcast it publicly, but tears and troubles and trials. And I've been praying all morning long, Lord, help us to be a blessing to them. Lord, let this be a breath of fresh air to them. And that's our prayer today. So you give as unto the Lord, and let's be a blessing to them. And I want you to listen to the choir as they sing one right before we open the Word of God this morning. Y'all sing.
He's been my fourth man in. part just says, I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. Do I have any witnesses in the room that can testify that with us? Say, I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord.
Stand to your feet, all the church choir. Go find your seat out in the house. My, 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 my. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Grab your Bibles this morning and turn with me to the book of 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles. I'm so thankful for the church house. Thankful for the place we get to go. I would rather be right here right now than anywhere in the whole wide world. 2 Chronicles chapter number 34. 2 Chronicles chapter number 34. Second Chronicles chapter 34 and verse number 1. If you're there on your phone or looking on the screen or however you're looking at it, let's take a look at God's word. Verse number 1, Josiah was 8 years old when he began to reign. And he reigned in Jerusalem 130 years. And he did that, watch this now, and he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Walked in the ways of David his father and declined neither to the right hand nor to the left hand. For in the 8th year of his reign, while he was yet young, he'd have been 16 years old now, he began to seek after the God of David his father. Listen to me, young person. Don't ever let anybody tell you that you can't seek after God in your younger years. He began to seek after the God of David his father, and in the 12th year he began to purge Judah and Jerusalem from the high places and the groves and the carved images and the molten images. And they break down the altars of Balaam in his presence and the images that were on high above them. He cut down and groves and carved images and the molten images he break in pieces and made dust of them. Look how serious he was. And made dust of them and strode it upon the graves of them that had sacrificed unto them. Some things you got to get rid of. Some things you can't put on custody and just, some things you got to get plumb rid of. And that's what he did. We come to verse numbers 14. Look at verse 14, where the Bible said, and when they brought out the money that was brought into the house of the Lord, Hilkiah the priest found a book of the law of the Lord given by Moses. And Hilkiah answered and said to Shaphan the scribe, I have found the book of the law in the house of the Lord. And Hilkiah delivered the book to Shaphan, and Shaphan carried the book to the king and brought the king word back again, saying, all that was committed to thy servants, they do it. They gathered together the money that was found in the house of the Lord, and he delivered it into the hands of the overseers and to the hand of the workmen. Then Shaphan the scribe told the king, saying, Hilkiah the priest hath given me a book. And Shaphan read it before the king, and it came to pass when the king had heard the words of the law that he rent his clothes. And the king commanded Hilkiah and Elkanah the son of Shaphan, the Abdon, the son of Micah, and Shaphan the scribe, and Isaiah the servant of the king, saying, go inquire of the Lord for me, watch this, for them that are left in Israel and in Judah concerning the words of the book that is found. For great is the wrath of the Lord that is poured out upon us, because our fathers have not kept the word of the Lord to do after all that is written in this book. He goes and repents before God, and the judgment that was coming to the land is stayed because Josiah had a tender heart and a repenting heart, because they lived thinking they were doing okay, only for them to go back and find the book, and the book found out they weren't doing okay. And Josiah repents of it. I want to deal with this for a few minutes this morning and preach on this subject. Lord, I was wrong. Spiritual maturity is not always being able to stand for what you consider to be your truth. Real spiritual maturity is when you can come to the place and say, Lord, I was wrong. Victory begins in your heart when you learn to say, Lord, I was wrong. Father, I pray you'd help us this morning. Touch your word, anoint your word, feed us from your word today. For it's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray, and all God's people said, you can be seated. This past week, I left church on Sunday and woke up 4 o'clock in the morning on Monday morning, headed to the airport, spent 2 days in the studio in Nashville working on some stuff for me and Becky, and had to fly back early Wednesday. To literally get home, spend 2 hours at home, and drive to Mount Airy, North Carolina, and preach Wednesday night. It was a crazy, crazy week. Daylight to dark, working Monday and Tuesday. And Wednesday morning, me and Ben Hart woke up in Nashville and were headed to the airport. I think our flight left at 5 o'clock Wednesday morning early. We had a conversation Tuesday night before we went to bed about what time we needed to get up, what time we needed to leave, and I'm pretty sure we communicated pretty clearly on what the expectation was to be there on time. I didn't sleep. How many of y'all have ever known you had to get up super early in the morning and then you don't sleep very good because you're afraid to death you're going to oversleep a little bit? Come on, y'all. I'm trying to be nice to myself because I'm about to tell y'all that I was late and I didn't even have Becky with me and I had nobody to blame, all right? I felt a spirit come over here. We got up that morning and I remember I didn't sleep, and I remember getting up early and the alarm clock not waking me up and feeling like, man, I'm ahead of schedule, I'm early, everything's fine. I was operating in pure peace. I remember one time they've been looking at me thinking, man, we did good today. This was super early. We didn't even need an alarm clock. And I strolled over. We checked the car back into the rental center there and got everything done. And just leisurely walking into the airport, no stress, no worry, no peace. I get to the I get to the area where we check in the bags and the Delta line there, and the man looks at me. He said, "Mr. Townsend, I'm terribly sorry to tell you this, but they won't let me check your bag." And I thought, why not? He said, "Sir, your flight leaves in 20 minutes. I still got to go through security. I still got to go all through. I'm in Nashville Airport. And I said, "What do you mean I've only got?" I said, "I'm early." He said, "No, sir, you're very late." And I had to scramble through there. He wouldn't check my bag. I had to beg people in security to help me to get my bag through. My bag was too big to go through all the security things. There was a mean dude who wasn't going to help me. And I finally said, "Is there anybody here that could please help me? Can somebody," y'all would have thought I was a complete meltdown. Can somebody please help me?" This lady said, "Sir, if you will empty your bag and put everything inside your bag, inside these little compartments, and then we'll hand check your bag." So I start grabbing drawers and all kinds of stuff out of the bag, just throwing it out there for everybody to see. Y'all know what drawers are. I put it all through the security breach and all this stuff, and they're checking my bag. I am literally huffing and puffing and running to the gate, and the lady finally lets me on the plane. And I sat there and thought, man, how in the world did I become late? How did that happen? And I still, this day, I don't really understand exactly what I did. All I know is the airport's time was right. My time was wrong. Did you know that there are people living in the society we live in every single day that have perfect peace, feeling like they are living in perfection and in righteousness? But one day they're going to stand before God and find out their time was wrong and God's time was right. They're going to find out that God's ways were right and their ways were wrong. Can I appeal to you and say that it is way better to fall on the mercy of God now and repent and say, "Lord, I was wrong now," instead of waiting to judgment? I don't have a long sermon today. I don't have a difficult sermon today, but I do hope and pray that you'll receive and think and give the Holy Spirit a chance to work in all of our hearts today. Because we see inside the life of Josiah several things about this. Thinking about the subject of, "Lord, I was wrong," getting to the place where all of us can understand that we were wrong. When you study the life of the people of God throughout history, you will find a cycle or a progression that is consistent inside nearly every chapter, every book. Anywhere you find the people of God, you will find this cycle. I'm going to need y'all to repeat it after me. Sin, say it. Sin. Oppression. Repentance. Deliverance. Sin would come in, and they would start worshiping false gods. They would start living their life. They would start going to the high places and the groves and living the worldly way. And what would happen? God would lift the hedge from their life, and here would come oppression and trouble and trial. It was not meant to hate them or to hurt them. It was meant and sent to get their attention, to get them to the place where sin would go from sin to oppression, and oppression would come to repentance. Without the hog lot, the prodigal son may have never thought about the father's house. It went sin to oppression, oppression to repentance, and repentance to deliverance. Now lean in and receive this with gladness and joy. It ain't always the devil's fault. Look at your neighbor and say, "He's preaching to you." Yeah. Because here's what we do in church. When we preach like this, we think, "Man, I hope so-and-so hears this. I hope my wife's listening to this." No, I'm talking to you. I'm talking to me. All of us are made out of the same old stuff. I tell you all the time, this ain't a perfect church. You ain't got a perfect preacher. You ain't got no perfect people. We are a bunch of flawed, imperfect people that had the propensity to make big mistakes and ruin everything about our life. And we find that there is progression in the lives of the people of God in the Old Testament that is alive and well, that flows exactly through you and exactly through me. There is this progression of sin and then oppression. Oppression looks, "Man, the devil's picking on me. The devil won't leave me alone." Maybe it has nothing to do with the devil at all. And it has to do with the fact that you keep making terrible choices. I am fed up with a woke, liberal ideology that has flowed with even in with the church today of this victim card. We all got this big old victim card. Man, we like to flip that victim card out and say, oh, I'm a victim. I've been hurt. I've been this. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been hurt too, but it ain't never been Jesus' fault. Matter of fact, if I'm going to be real honest, some of the worst points in my life and the worst seasons of my life wasn't my mama's fault. It wasn't my daddy's fault. It wasn't the church's fault. It wasn't my boss's fault. It wasn't society's fault. It was my choices that caused bad circumstances. You can choose your sin, but you don't get to choose your consequences. And we find, number one, the king's stance in verse number two. The king's stance in verse number two. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, and walked in the ways of David his father, and declined neither to the right hand nor to the left. If I have a prayer for our young people, it's that you'll live a life like Josiah. If I have a prayer for our married couples in our church, it's that you'll have a heart like Josiah. That a heart that could be said of your life that he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, and walked in the ways of David his father, and declined neither to the right hand nor to the left hand. How many of y'all know there is a lane called balance? It's not the right lane and it's not the left lane, but it's right there in the middle where Jesus has always been, in the middle. I'm not going to the right. I'm not going to the left. I'm going to be right in the middle where Jesus is. And we see that the king's stance was a stance of balance, right in the middle, saying, I'm not going to the right too far and I'm not going to the left too far. I'm going to be right in the middle of the will of God. May it be said of us that we did that which is right in the sight of the Lord. We don't only see the king's stance, but we see in verse 3 the king's seeking. The Bible says in verse number 3, for in the eighth year, when he was 16 years old, in the eighth year of his reign, while he was yet young, he began to seek after the God of David, his father. And in him seeking after the God of David, his father, he so got the zeal of God on the inside that he began to purge the nation of all the false gods and little g gods so that it could be a place that is well-pleasing unto God. And I believe in 2024 that it is still possible and it is still right and it is still admirable for a person to wake up every day of their life and say, I want the purpose of my life to be that of seeking the Lord with my life. Aren't you thankful that if we diligently seek after him, that he will let us find him? But he's not, it is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but you find me someone that gets hungry for the righteousness of God and the goodness of God and says, more than I want wealth and fame, more than I want notoriety or popularity, I want to seek the Lord with my life. Ladies and gentlemen, may I tell you that there are people with billions of dollars to their account and they still don't know what peace and happiness and favor is all about. Ladies and gentlemen, I can show you people that don't have nothing but the monetary systems of this world, but they know what the favor of God is, and they know what the blessing of God is, and they know what the goodness of God is. I'm here to tell you that for the child of God, you can be rich and not have a dime in your bank account. I said you can be rich and not have a single dime in your bank account, because it is not what you got, it is who you got that matters all the day long. Because you may not have anything this world speaks of being wealthy, but if you have favor with God, he will pay the bills. He will take you places you never thought you could go before. He will usher you into seasons you didn't deserve and couldn't pay for. I'm telling you, he had it right when he started seeking the God of heaven in his early days. One of my favorite verses in the Word of God is Psalm chapter number 27 and verse number 4, where the Bible said, one thing have I desired desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Preacher, why is it important from a young age all the way through life to seek after God? Because I can take you back to when I was a teenager and my mom and daddy, they drug me to church every time the doors were open, and there were times when I may not have paid attention. There were times when my ADHD, XYZ, and all the above abbreviations got a hold of my mind, and maybe I wasn't paying attention as good as I should, but I can take you to the exact moment. I can take you to the exact bench. I can take you to the exact service where the Holy Ghost of God arrested my soul and arrested my heart. Tears ran down my eyes. Something got a hold of me that I'll never get over. It was like electricity from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet as the Holy Ghost of God got a hold of my life. And hear me, I was introduced to the world. I wasn't always a perfect kid. I went places I wish I hadn't have went. I'd done things I wish I hadn't have done. But hear me, I never could get over what I found in those early days of seeking after God. And may I unapologetically tell every single one of us that there is nothing that this world has to offer that will beat what the Holy Ghost can do for you and in you and with you. And it is the job and it is the goal of my heart that we have a Holy Ghost church so that our kids can find a place on an altar and find peace on an altar. And when the world does come calling their name, that they won't stay in the world, because just like the prodigal son inside the hog pen said, I will arise and go to the Father. My daddy's servants have got it better than I've got it out here. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, oh God, help us to seek after the Lord. Help us to chase after the Lord, not after religion, not after being a good Baptist, not after dotting the I's and crossing the T's, but after saying, I want to seek the Lord with my life. The king's stance. The king's seeking. We also see in the Word of God the king's source. Everything is fixing to get messed up bad. In verse 14, they find the book. They find the book, and it is the perfect law of God. They find this book. They bring it before the king, and the king says, oh, no. We've been thinking we've been doing okay. We've been thinking we've been doing all right. But now we've read this book, and we find out that our fathers haven't been following the Lord, and we haven't been following the Lord, because we may have been following what man's ways said was right. But now we read God's word, and we find that we are off base. Why is it important that we are Bible-centric? Why is it important that we are Bible-centered? The world laughs at this book. There are pop singers that make little jabs at it and little statements at it and call it an old book, an old-fashioned book, and it's irrelevant for the day and hour in which we live. But ladies and gentlemen, I will tell you that the reason America is in the shape that it's in today, and the reason America has went from a blessed, prosperous nation to a nation that can't even pay our bills, wars and rumors of wars, internal division, external division, trouble on every single side, I believe we can all agree that a long time ago, our fathers quit walking in the ways of this book. And it doesn't matter who we put in the White House in November. I've got my rathers. I've got my wishes. I've got the way I would like things to go. But hear me, at the end of the day, the issues are so deeply rooted within our nation. America does not need a new president hoping he will fix it all. America needs an old-fashioned revival of the Word of God, where we get back to the ways of God, and the ways of our forefathers. There is a way which seemeth right to a man, but the ways of the end of the ways of death. And ladies and gentlemen, this Bible always has been right, and this Bible is right, and this Bible will continue to be right. And if you want real peace and real joy and what real happiness is all about, you won't find it in a bank account, and you won't find it in a new car or a new house. All the vanity that this world displays in front of us today and now, it doesn't have the ability to make you happy or bring any joy. Oh, but there is something found inside the Word of God when we set the course of our life that says, more than I want to look good to men, I want to look good to God. And ladies and gentlemen, you will find that life down here is so very short, and eternity is going to be so very long. And all the fool that lives their life for the short period of time and doesn't think about the pressure of eternity down the road, ladies and gentlemen, the King's source will change from being what he thought was right to finding the Word of God. And ladies and gentlemen, if we're going to have any kind of revival in this day and hour, it will not come from a man's education. It will not come from a man's opinion. It will not come from a man's theology. But ladies and gentlemen, it must come from the source of the Word of God. This Bible is still powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. I wish I had some help on Sunday morning. This Bible is more relevant than tomorrow's newspaper. This Bible has laid out everything that was, and this Bible has laid out everything that ever will be. You say, preacher, did you hear about the attacks in Israel yesterday? Preacher, have you looked at the economy? Preacher, have you looked at things spiraling out of control? Preacher, have you looked at the ratings of the election that's coming up? Preacher, have you looked at the status of what's going on with the teenagers and drug use and all the stuff that's crazy? Preacher, have you looked at the stats of the divorce rate in America? Preacher, have you looked at the alcoholism rate? Have you looked at the drug use rate? Preacher, have you looked at all the news channels and seen how much is going bad in the society we're living in? Preacher, have you seen this or have you seen that? Oh, I've seen that. But ladies and gentlemen, I've already read the back of the book, and the Bible said, when you see these things, to look up, for your redemption draweth nigh. I'm not worried. I'm not anxious. I'm not nervous. I'm not looking for the undertaker. I'm looking for the upper taker. Everything God wanted me to know, he told me inside that word. And ladies and gentlemen, if I could pastor you for a little minute, get your face off the news channel and get your face out of Facebook. Get your face out of Instagram. Get your eyes off of TikTok and get it back in the Word of God. And you'll find we have a wonderful Savior, a good Savior, a holy Savior. You don't have to be fearful. You don't have to be worried. David said, I've been young and I've been old, and I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread. I wish I had some encouraged people that could rise up and tell the devil, not today, Satan. I done got me a Bible. I done got me a handbook. And then the God of all glory said, I'm going to make it to the other side. Hallelujah. Glory to God. The worst thing that can happen to me is heaven with streets of gold and gates of pearl. Child of God, pick your head up. We make it to the other side. One of my first Bibles that my parents gave me, my dad wrote in it in the back and my mom wrote in the front. My mom was short and to the point. She said these words, sin will keep you from this Bible, or this Bible will keep you from sin. How you treat it will matter which one wins. And this book is something you only see on Sunday. And if it's only something you open up when the preacher says to turn to the passage he's going to preach from that day, you will consistently be defeated. Lean up and listen. A part-time Christian will never defeat a full-time devil. I said a part-time Christian will never defeat a full-time devil. Weak, anemic, watered-down Christianity. Come to church on Sunday. Preacher, give me my little IV of the Bible so I can live the rest of the week. Then you turn on Hank Williams and you turn on all the worldly music and you turn on everything this world has to offer and you turn on the country station and every marriage is in divorce. Everything's going crazy. Then you turn on the other. Everybody's sleeping around doing drugs and celebrating life and the world itself. I don't know why I can't feel God. I don't know why I can't sense God. I don't know why my marriage is falling apart. I don't know why my kids don't want nothing to do with God. I'll tell you why. Because you're a part-time Christian at best. And if you're going to have power in your life and live in the power of God, it's not going to be by hazardly or just tippy-toeing through religion and then just claiming Jesus on Sunday and dating Jesus on Sunday and then living with the world the rest of the week. We got to get, listen to me, there's a generation of teenagers. I hope God's fearful. I hope that God is long-suffering with you, because there's a generation of young people that have learned to do everything I'm saying, where they just come to church on Sunday and they know how to get up there. They know how to dress. They know how to act. They know how to talk. But ladies, this ain't a game. This ain't a game called Christianity. They learned how to talk it. They learned how to walk it. They've learned how to say it. But you go find their text messages. You go find their Instagram. You go find the real who they are. And you will find a wretchedness. You will find a worldliness. You will find way more of a worldly mind than a godly mind. And all of us mess up. But ladies and gentlemen, if you will stick in that Bible and spend time with that Bible, you won't have to have a mom and daddy that yell at you all the time. Why? Because that Bible will steer you in the right direction. Hey, it don't matter how the world dresses and how the world lives and how the world acts. It ought not be the youth pastor or the pastor tells you that when it's springtime and summertime, that don't give you a right to get half naked and post pictures all over every social media platform across the world. You ought to know that God deserves more out of that than you and I do. Listen, I'm just telling you, ladies and gentlemen, it doesn't have to be the preacher telling you what to do. Get you a Bible and let the Bible dictate how you live and act and talk and walk and be an example of the believer and live a life that is not a part-time Christian.
If you want to be a part-time Christian, please stay away from my kids. I don't need nobody influencing my kids that that's the good way to live. This is too important. We only get to do this one time. And I want to please God with our life. We see the king's source is the word of God. Then lastly, the king's saving. 2 weeks in a row, done before 11:45. And as for the king of Judah, he sent to inquire of the Lord, so shall ye say unto him, thus saith the Lord God of Israel concerning the words which thou hast heard, because thine heart was tender, and thou didst humble thyself before God, when thou heardest his words against this place and against the inhabitants thereof, and humblest thyself before me, and didst rend thy clothes and weep before me, I have heard thee also. Saith the Lord, behold, I will gather thee to thy fathers, and thou shalt be gathered to thy grave in peace. Neither shall thine eyes see all the evil that I will bring upon this place and upon the inhabitants of the same. Help me, Jerry, and I'm done. Look what the Lord said when he repents. God said, when thou heardest his words against this place and against the inhabitants thereof, and humblest thyself before me, and didst rent thy clothes and weep before me, I have heard thee. Up in the first part, he said, thus saith the Lord God of Israel concerning the words which thou hast heard. I love this part. Because thine heart was tender. On a level of 1 to 10, how tender is your heart? Sin will callous and harden a heart. And it don't matter. These are some of the best singers God ever made. But for some of you, your heart's so crusted over. It don't matter if we'd brought George Beverly Shea singing with Gabriel the Archangel today, a duet. Don't matter what kind of preaching you hear. You just here to check a little box. Went to church on Sunday. Can I tell you, I've been there. Where we just turn on the robot mode and we just start being a robot through life. Go to church. Do what we're supposed to do. So that we look good to man. God doesn't look on the outside. God looks on the inside. You can do all the right things with the wrong motive, and none of it count at all. I want to have a tender heart. Yeah. Tucker gets mad at me because he says I embarrass him sometimes. We was out yesterday, and it was a gorgeous day. We was walking around that golf course, a couple pastor friends. Man, anybody that loves golf and gets out there in that beautiful weather like yesterday, I'm walking around. I got tears running down my cheeks. And I thought, ain't God good? Look at all. Look how beautiful it is. Tucker said, oh, here goes Daddy again. Here goes Daddy. I want to have a tender heart. I want it because I've lived through seasons where I didn't have it. Man, when you don't have a tender heart, everything looks bad. You'll sit in church and the carpet's the wrong color. The service is either too short or it's too long. It's too loud or it's too quiet. It's too hot or it's too cold. You didn't like the songs Josh picked. You didn't like the singers that he let sing. Come on, y'all. Don't make me. I'll find out who you are. Go to picking things apart, picking people apart. That's way more of an indicator of your heart instead of theirs. But we see in Josiah the bottom picture of how he was able to do things right to lead an entire kingdom. That was, he kept a tender heart. You can live in a rough society and still maintain a tender heart. I want my wife to feel like she lives with a husband with a tender heart. I want my kids to feel like they have a daddy with a tender heart. I want to pastor a church with a tender heart where the Holy Ghost can lead and guide. I'm not always perfect at that. Probably more than less. But my question to you leaving is, how tender is your heart? Is it tender enough for you to be able to stop long enough to say, Lord, I was wrong. This one may not be the devil's fault. This one's not my mom's fault, or my dad's fault, or my friend's fault. But Lord, it could be that the season I'm walking in of despair and trouble could have more to do that I have sought after all these other things instead of you. And this is the fruit of my reward for seeking everything except the Lord. Now, it's not always that way. I will tell you, sometimes the devil is messing with us. Maybe I'll preach on that next Sunday. Because there have been times when we have been doing right and done everything we know to do right, and the devil comes in and attacks. So I'm not saying that every trouble is because you've done wrong. You know I'm not saying that. But there are times when it ain't got nothing to do with the devil. It's got a whole lot to do with it. God, help us to be able to look at our entire life just like Josiah did and say, Lord, reveal to me anything and everything that's not pleasing to you so that I can confess it and forsake it and live and walk in the blessing of God for my life. with heads bowed and eyes closed. I want to do things a little bit different today than usual. I want to pray over our church family. And I wonder how many would lift up a hand and say, Pastor CT, while you're preaching today, the Lord has put his hand on a couple areas of my life that are not pleasing unto him. I was thinking this morning, praying through this, I still remember some older services way back in the day when we'd preach like this and people would walk up to the altars and lay packs of cigarettes on the altar. They would lay worldly music on the altar. We ain't done that in a while, but that would be so good for us. Sins that we've accepted and found peace in. Everything seems to be going well, but the Holy Ghost has shined his light on today that just is not right for us. Maybe it's the way you communicate. Maybe it's the way you talk. Maybe it's things you've been looking at. Maybe it's things you've been consuming. I don't know. But today, if the Holy Spirit has put his finger on something in your life that needs to go, then right here and right now, I want you to throw your hand up and say, Preacher, I want you to pray for me that God would give me the strength to remove these things from my life. Here's my hand, Preacher. I heard God this morning. I acknowledge God this morning. There's some things in my life that need to go. There's a bunch of y'all being honest and some of y'all not being honest. Preacher, there's some things in my life that need to go. Father, in Jesus' name, you see every hand. God, you know everything that they're going through, everything they're struggling with. And I pray, God, you'd give them the strength that they need to remove those things from their life. Lord, let us walk in your blessing. In Jesus' name, heads are bowed, eyes are closed. You can take your hands down. I wonder, would there be any in this room that would say, Pastor CT, I got to be honest, while you're preaching today, I've been convicted because I'm not even 100% sure that I'm saved. I'm not 100% sure that I'm saved, but I'm 100% sure that I don't want to die and go to hell. If that's you, I would not embarrass you for anything in the world, but I do want to pray for you. If there's anybody here say, Preacher, I'm not 100% sure I'm saved, right now, would you throw a hand up and put it right back down? Preacher CT, please pray for me. Please pray for me. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. I pray, God, you'd help us to forsake anything that's not pleasing unto you. God, help us do what Josiah did and to walk in the blessing of God. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask the Neelands to sing one. And I want you all to come back to church tonight at 5 o'clock. We're going to turn them loose, and we're going to have a good old time. But y'all listen to them sing one more for us.
My strength is gone. My heart is full of sorrow. I can't believe.
Until
So please forgive me. I can't believe the God of earth and glory would take the time to care for one like me. See, I've read the Bible, I've read the old, old story. As he bled, Jesus came when my heart.
sing this all day today.
Through it all, thank God, through it all, I've learned
to depend on.
Somebody help me praise the Lord. Josh, we got any announcements on the way out? Are we good to go? Huh? Hospitality room, if you're a guest or a visitor with us today, right behind that wall, through those doors to the right, me and Becky will be back there. We want to meet all of our guests today. And other than that, 5 o'clock tonight, you choir practice or no choir practice? Let's do no choir. Let's give them a day off. No choir practice tonight. Everybody be here at 5 o'clock. And if you ain't here, I'm going to come find you. Somebody say amen. God bless you. Have a great day.